Coming up on Meet the Collectors, we'll visit with a Vancouver radio personality who keeps a close eye on his collection of vintage cameras. We'll tour what looks like a small town created at the home of a husband and wife collecting team. And we'll show you how one collector's tribute to the King of Rock and Roll has taken over her home. That's all ahead on Meet the Collectors. Welcome, everybody. I'm Red Robinson. Vancouver radio personality Cam McCubbin realized he had an obsession with cameras after a visit with a friend who owned a camera store. Now, that was four decades ago, and he's been collecting ever since.
I've been hanging around junk stores and antique markets and flea markets and garage sales for 40 years, picking up photography items. And it's blossomed, though, from cameras. Initially, it was cameras that got kept in boxes and what have you. But then as you go through life as a collector of anything, you get friends and relatives who are looking for something for Christmas, but they don't want to buy you a collectible because they don't know anything about that. But they'll buy you a little figurine with a camera. Camera like this. It's got a camera in it. And so over the years, I began to realize I was accumulating a larger collection of what I call camaraderies. The oddity, the ephemera from the camera world, than I did cameras. And when you start looking around some of the display cabinets in my camera room, you'll see that the cameras have sort of faded into the background on the shelf, and they're backdrop now for the camaraderies, the little people with cameras and little cars with Kodak on them and the little dolls that I got a beautiful little bear in a tartan kilt who happens to be carrying a little Kodak camera. And of course, you discover eBay. You know, you get into the last 10 years, and if you're truly obsessive, you're broke and you've gone nuts.
This obsession has driven Cam to collect hundreds of cameras, but don't ask him to put an exact number on it.
I wish I could figure that out. I tried once to, because I had to cull. I tried to keep it down to about 500 cameras. They're all still cameras, with a few exceptions of movie cameras. I've got a Kodak Century studio camera, a studio portrait camera, which is huge. And of course, when you become known as a collector, people tend to bring you cameras, and the antique stores that you haunt see something in Britain and say, oh, Cam will love this. Well, that's what happened when they brought this back. Cam will love this. It's a studio camera. Well, I haven't got room for it, but it's been there with me. It's like an old friend. This old Kodak Century has been with me for probably 30 of my 40 camera collecting years, and it's gone everywhere I've gone, and it gets moved, and I don't think I could part with it now. It's a pretty nice old camera.
Even with his friends watching for items that Cam might like to add to his collection, he still has a favorite place to seek out his next great finds.
Garage sales. Actually, garage sales are, I think, the last bastion of the true bargain. Because at a lot of the flea markets, you've got dealers. A lot of the shows are definitely dealers. But there are twice a year camera shows here in Vancouver, which are excellent to go to because you get to rub shoulders with fellow collectors, fellow obsessives, and you wander into a sea of black and chrome. My wife, the first time we went to a camera show, she went, oh, it's all black and chrome. There's no color. I guess is why I got into camaraderies too, with the little colorful guys. It adds a lot to the display, you know, more interest.
And at a garage sale is where Cam found one of his more unusual cameras.
I collect toy cameras as well. Not just novelties, but toy cameras that aren't really cameras. They're the kindergarten kind of thing. You know, I don't know why, but I've got boxes of them. They're all on my website. But I was at a garage sale, and I saw a toy camera, a little pink toy camera. And I thought, how much for the toy camera? She said, it goes with the doll. I said, I don't want the doll. Keep the doll. She says, $10 goes with the doll. And I said, no, you keep the doll. You can sell the doll for $10. I just want the camera. She said, when you point the camera at the doll changes pose. I went, I like this. Her name is Susie Snapshot. And every time you flash the camera, the flash hits the light receptor on her necklace, and she changes pose. I know. It's a little crazy.
Susie Snapshot isn't the only crazy camera in Cam McCubbin's collection. And we'll show you more of them when Meet the Collectors returns in a moment. Welcome back. More now of our visit with camera collector Cam McCubbin. Now, we showed you earlier one of Cam's largest cameras, his Kodak Century Studio Camera. But on the other end of the scale, and you'll understand my pun in a second, is a $1,000 disposable camera that may be in only one or two other collections.
It's a gastrointestinal pill that you swallow, and it takes 58,000 photographs of your everything from your teeth to the other end when it comes out in 12 hours. It takes two pictures per second, 58,000 of them, and transmits them to a hard drive on your attached to your belt. And so it's much more comfortable than what do they call those things? The colonoscopy going where no man has gone before. This one, it's a pill that size, and it is in the pill. It has a light source, four LED lights, a camera, a transmitter, and an antenna, all in the size of a swallowable pill. Pretty incredible.
Cam also has in his collection some other small, if less well-traveled, cameras.
Walter Kunick was a company in Germany in the 50s that, after the war, decided to spend some time and effort on frivolities rather than war machines. And they turned out some fabulous sub-miniature cameras. One of the rarest is the Petey Vanity camera. And the Petey Vanity camera looks like a woman's compact. Actually, it looks like a camera, but it is a woman's compact. But it has a tiny little Petey built into one corner of it, so that when you hold this camera up and press the button, voila, rather than taking a picture, the mirror pops up and the powder puff appears so that you can powder your nose with your camera. I mean, everybody should have one of those, shouldn't they? Lipstick built right in on where the film winder is. There's a tube of lipstick in the camera as well. The Kunick Petey Vanity camera. They're somewhere well over $1,000 now, US, for one of those. The Expo Detective camera is a camera that's actually a hidden camera in a pocket watch, and it looks very much like a pocket watch from the turn of the century. The winder of the pocket watch is actually the lens cap, so when you go to wind your pocket watch, you pull off that, the lens cap, aim your watch at whatever you're detecting, and click, push the button, and away it goes. And I have one in the original box, and the original box says for professional police use only. They were $1.50. But they're a wonderful little collectible. Earlier, when cameras had bellows, way back, if you wanted to hide a camera, you put it in a box. And that was called a detective camera. And I've got a huge Watson detective camera, which is a bellows camera inside what looks to be, when it's closed, a toolbox. And it has a little, barely detectable, little lens opening. And the controls are underneath the box so that you can't see them when it's sitting down as your lunch pail or your toolbox or whatever it was intended to be back in about 1890 as well. My collection's at the point now where any camera or camera oddity comes in, another one has to leave because my space is finite. My wife won't let any of this out of this room. So there's no cameras anywhere else in the house except my digital. And so one camera comes in, another's got to go. I'm not a completist, so I allow my collection to complete itself. I gather the items together and then I'll go, I have a lot of these. I must like them. And so I've got, you'll see cameras grouped around the camera room that have just formed together as a collector. I tend to go with the law of, I don't know, there must be some galactic law that says like items gather and I know where to find them. That's the rule of McCubbin.
It seems that the rule of McCubbin extends to Cam's family and friends as well.
Most of my family and friends are just as obsessive as I am, so it's wonderful, because when I go to garage sales, I'm also looking for Mercury Living Presence stereo recordings from the 50s, in the early 60s, rather. I've got an obsessive friend who collects those. I've got an obsessive friend who collects rubber squeak toys, believe it or not. I've got, my father has a Buddha collection, a smiling, happy Buddha collection across his mantle, fireplace mantle, that is starting to get overgrown as well. My stepmother collects Swedish, no, not Swedish, sorry Janice, Norwegian trolls. The big ugly ones with the nose, not the little rubber guys, but the great big ugly trolls. She's got a huge collection of those under her grand piano, so I'm always looking for those. So, yeah, they're not only supportive, they're sick as well.
There's nothing sick about being able to share your interests with those you care about, even if they do collect big ugly trolls under the piano.